see a go daddy knockout of the night here between Mia Smell and Edward Keller. Inside leg early from Mia Smell. Queen Kumai and judo stylist. If Kelly knocks out the Cambodian, this place will go bananas. Oh, there's the left.
Oh! Listen!
Into the record books.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Yuji Shimada, has put a stop to this contest after 21 seconds in the first round for your winner by way of knockout, Edward Kelly.
Well, we saw Jo Marie Torres with the fastest ever women's knockout in one championship history. That's got to be up there. Knockout in the men's for the ferocious Edward Kelly.
Ready, fight!
In front of 20,000 fans, packed with celebrities and fight fans. What a night. A great stage for Bonario to give us his best performance.
13 is a tall lightweight. We rarely see people out kind of, you know, height advantage on Bonario, but Jartim is big. Bonario's pressing Jartim up against the cage now. Again, I asked him, I was like, what do you want to showcase here tonight? What are you looking for in front of your crowd here in Manila? And he was like, I want another submission win. So he's calling his shot, saying he wants to take Jartim down and finish him on the floor. And that's kind of exactly what he's doing. Dropping down, changing levels. Jartim goes for the ride. Bonario gets into side control.
He seems so much stronger at lightweight, Bonario.
Oh yeah, this is one of the individuals that the weight cutting.
Yeah, really benefited, yeah.
Extreme, like we're seeing an entirely new Bonario as he's not able, because he doesn't have to worry about the massive weight cut. And he walks around at 79 kilos.
He can concentrate on his conditioning at a comfortable weight, at a strong weight. And that's what we've seen from him in the last year or so.
He says he has to diet down so he can't eat as much, but he has to lose a little bit of body fat to make the weight. Without the weight cutting, without the water restriction, he's a completely different athlete.
Just one of so many world champions in the arena tonight. Honorio Bonario, the former featherweight title holder, Eduard Foalyang is coming up. Angela Lee's here, Brandon Vera's here, Rich Franklin's here, Manny Pacquiao's here.
Action!
Nice transition from Jartim. Bonario tried to go knee on belly. He was thinking about, Jartim started to turn. He was thinking about taking the back, but Jartin was able to out kind of maneuver Benario and end up on top here.
Approaching the halfway mark, opening round. Benario takes a cuffing right hand and gets up and spins his man around and knees him to the hip, sends it a right hand to the side of Jartin's body. Thump to the upper thigh.
It all counts.
They all do. You don't see many of those, though.
It all counts. A strike is a strike.
Action!
Sometimes you're with the shoulder, sometimes it's a punch to the thigh. And they do irritate you. You can set up something. So if you slap somebody on the thigh, you get them thinking about something else. And you can probably transition into something different.
Not happy that there's enough action going on. Throws them to the center of the cage, and they get straight into it.
Benario goes again for the takedown.
Whoa, took a big up kick from the sole of the foot there from Jartin. And it made a slapping sound.
And Jartin goes for a takedown of his own. Very well done. Slid right under the punch, got the double leg. Now puts Benario on his back. Benario able to stand back up, press Jartin up against the cage. He's got two underhooks now. So he's gonna be able to get a little bit better body control. He's got that head pressed up against the cage there.
Back into the center of the cage, Honorio Benario, and then gets pushed back across the cage. Hand around Benario's leg, and you can see the height difference.
See, this clinch fighting is such a strategic game. You know, you've got to make sure you get your head in the right position, that head pressing up against Jartin. See how he's got his head underneath the chin of Jartin? Opens up, keeps the head high so he can slide an elbow right in there. Brandon Vera liked that one quite a bit.
Just looking at them there, they really have made another slapping sound, didn't it? There it is, that forearm again.
That's exactly what he needs to do when he gets this cage position. Keep the head open, open him up, drop in these strikes.
First time we've seen Jaroslav Jartin, 24 years old. Spent a lot of time in Prague in the Czech Republic. That's where he learned his game. There's Manny Pacquiao in the locker room with Eugene Toquero and Victor Cui. Enjoying the atmosphere, I'm quite sure. Chan Rotana looking for a photo as well with the former World Boxing Champion.
Big round for Benario. Let's see if Brandon Vera has that one scored so far. Brandon?
So, you know, it seems like both of these guys are going, it's a battle of attrition right now, first round. Both guys are kind of steady at their pace. They're taking each other down, working on the reversals and getting back up. A lot of ground control from both fighters. Let's see what happens. Have them open up on their feet next round.
Seconds out, please. Seconds out.
There's that forearm to the head of Jartin. Benario's style has changed fairly significantly in recent times. We talked about the weight difference and how he is stronger, but Team Lakay as a whole have improved their grappling games, specifically their takedown defense.
But now you would almost think that Benario was naturally a wrestler and a grappler. Big head kick there, just barely misses Benario, slid underneath it. And again, he goes right in for the takedown. This is definitely something that we're not used to seeing. Benario consistently shooting for takedowns and not throwing those heavy hands and kick strikes.
A lot of Filipinos who get into the fight game started off just messing around with something that I think they call bouton, which is a form of wrestling. And that is where Benario started. Kevin Baling on as well, very much had that kind of a background before being schooled in Wushu and transforming their activities to a striking-based martial art.
Here he is in the half guard of Jartim. So he's gonna wanna try to pop that leg out. He's got the right leg inside the half guard of Jartim, so he's gonna wanna try to slide that knee out, pass into side control. Jartim's doing the right thing by turning onto his side so he's not lying flat onto his back. Good reversal by Jartim to end up on top.
It's a great effort from the Czech fighter.
Benario just stands right back up and throws Jartim up against the cage.
That's the strength of Benario.
Oh, left hand! Knocks him flat on his back! And with one punch, Honorio Benario extends his winning streak to four. That was a blistering finish.
Immediately got some separation and threw a bomb of a left to hook. Brandon Vera, talk us through that one.
You know, that was textbook counter to a Muay Thai kick. But Benario ate a tie kick to the ribs, countered right away, loaded up, same side, and pulled that left hook, hit him right on the chin and laid him out flat on his back. Here's the replay, kick, hook, straight, hook, lay him down. That is textbook Muay Thai counters. Eat the kick, load up, roll that hook.
Oh, what a hook!
You can't teach it any better than Benario executes right here. Even ends with the, he starts with a straight after the kick and follows up with the hook. Amazing job. Team Lakay, putting in work.
Dude, you said it, Team Lakay. They just go on and on and on, don't they?
They don't stop. Iron He's sharpens iron.
Ladies and gentlemen, to present the medal for this fight, we have Jeff Andres, property president of City of Dreams Manila, and the City of Dream guest ring girls. And now, folks, your referee, Yuji Shimada, has put a stop to this fight after 1 minute and 31 seconds in the second round. For your winner, by way of knockout, Honorio Benario!
Well, that is going to go down, isn't it? We're only in April, but that got to go down as one of the finishes of the year. 2017 will be very lucky if it sees many better finishes than that.
Ready? Ready? Fight!
We're set for 3 by 5 minute rounds. The Aussie in the blue, the Filipino in the red. Jab two early on here from Lightning Reese McLaren.
Kevin Belagong is known for that lightning fast front kick that seems to come out of nowhere. Just how long until he throws it?
McLaren had an 8-week camp on Australia's Gold Coast up north in Queensland, said he worked on bridging the gap between his striking to his takedowns. Jab two again and a double jab from Reese McLaren.
Reese McLaren immediately starts with the taunting. Oh, what a right hand!
Beautiful right hand from Belagong. McLaren in trouble. Here comes Belagong. Could it be the GoDaddy knockout of the night on the way? Belagong driving in the left hand, driving in the right hand. And McLaren reaches up, pulls him down. He's got to control the posture. He's got to stop the ground and pound.
Those are some huge shots thrown by Belagong, but what heart! About it all week, Michael, out of nowhere, the right hand comes, the ground and pound swarms on top of McLaren, avoided a lot of shots, but took a lot in the process. Belagong just put it on him till Olivier was forced to jump in and stop the contest.
Could that be the GoDaddy knockout of the night award right there? Kevin Belagong scales the cage afterwards. Simply amazing scenes here at One Championship Quest for Greatness. Let's go to Dominic Lau and make it official.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee Olivier Costa has put a stop to this fight after 1 minute and 2 seconds in the first round. For your winner, by way of knockout, Kevin Belagong.
For the Australian Reese McLaren, jubilation for the Philippines, Kevin Belagong. 14 years difference.
The older statesman, Roy Deligues, in the white and blue. A 21-year-old Pascio in the red. Southpaw stance as always on Deligues as he fakes a jab. Beautiful cracking roundhouse kick to the ribs there from Pascio. Said he wants to stay at kickboxing range, not sit in the pocket, not be in boxing range with Deligues. Quite smart.
Yeah, that kicking range really makes these Team Lakay athletes so dangerous. Look at his footwork, the way he floats around the outside of the cage. Oh, beautifully, again, catches him with that right kick. That's three now he's caught him with.
In typical boxer fashion, however, Roy Deligues looks to control center cage. And Chris Pascio to the outside. Pascio suits in. Nice sprawl there from Deligues. Defensive takedown. Can't defend it. That's a trick reversal here. Deligues looks for top position dragon.
Deligues does a beautiful job controlling that underhook of Pascio and using that wizard to get him over on top. Now, Pascio's got double underhooks. This is where Team Lakay really excels in the takedowns.
Takedown from Pascio, top position. Mounts him. Great finds the legs here. Dominance from Joshua Pascio.
So strong in that clinch position. And look at that, he was just able to fall on top and land in full mount.
Not where the boxer Deligues wants to be, though he said he's not afraid to go to the ground with Pascio. Believes that he's got a few submission tricks up his proverbial sleeve. Still mounting here. Those legs being grapevined by Joshua Pascio.
Don't hit it back over half.
Nice little pop in the right hand to the orbital there, then switches to the left as Pascio.
Good control, trying to keep the pressure down. You can see Deligues trying to control the posture of Pascio. Pascio's in a good spot, but big bridge by Deligues to reverse the position to end up on top.
Now it's Roy Deligues inside the guard of Pascio. 3 minutes remaining, first round, set for 3 by 5.
You know, it was surprising, Michael, to hear Deligues talk about he knew that Pascio was going to take him down. So he was working specifically on submissions to catch Pascio.
Pascio said he'd submit with an armbar or a rear naked choke. He did ask Deligues if you were going to submit Pascio, what do you think you'd catch him with? And he said rear naked. Inside closed guard here, trying to pop the head out. Deligues free of any danger right now.
Time.
Looks like we got a referee timeout. Looks like there possibly could have been a headbutt. Maybe an eye poke when he was trying to get his hands, trying to get free from the guillotine. We're going to show that again in a replay, but I think he had his hands on his face and he was trying to pry his head out of the guillotine.
Yellow card being issued there from referee Kim Chang. Yuji Shimada also having words there with Deligues. So Deligues has been punished here for this pitch.
Yeah, right there. As he was trying to get his hands out, he had his fingers in the eye of Joshua Pascio. That's a dangerous move right there, and he was issued a yellow card for that specific move.
Only been brought onto the one championship team recently, but already doing an outstanding job.
Right on.
And he will recommence the pitch from the position they were in.
Back into the guard now. Deligues is on top. They're going to actually restart him back in the guillotine position with his head trapped under his arm.
And Deligues has the head free. Is Pascio going to try and apply another choke? Probably not the best for this position. Deligues looking to push him up against the cage perhaps. Where does Pascio go from here, Mitch?
He's going to try to scoot his hips back against the cage and use it to wall walk back up. Now he's trying to scoot his hips out to the side, possibly looking to take the back of Deligues, but Deligues is following the hips.
Deligues trying to posture up and maybe work the hammer fist strike off the right hand. Elbows to the clavicle there from Pascio. 1 minute 40 remains, first round set for 3. What's Deligues looking to do here, Mitch?
It looks like Pascio is actually attempting to go after the Kimura there on the right side of Deligues, possibly looking to sweep him over. But yeah, there's the Kimura fully locked in.
And Deligues defended.
Look at that, uses it, the Kimura, not as so much as a submission attempt, but really just to sweep Deligues and end up in the top position, now in mount.
Knee bar or rear naked choke was a prediction from Pasio. Dominguez now top position, back inside the guard of Pasio. We are seeing truly a seesawing contest on the ground here in the first dragon.
That's the third time that Dominguez has been able to hit bridge out of the mount position. So those are some tremendously strong hips, Michael, for him to keep doing that to Pasio.
Dominguez said he'd been working on his ground game, said he felt quite comfortable to go to ground with Pasio. 4-week training camp for Roy Dominguez. A massive 2-month camp for Joshua Pasio.
Again, hunting for that Kimura on that right side. He's going to use the same thing. It's deja vu. The same moves keep happening. Look for Dominguez to bridge out of this.
As Pasio postures up, Dominguez tries to throw the legs up. Pasio doing some damage. Elbows now to the forehead from Joshua Pasio. These will score well for the young gun. Dominguez nowhere to go. Final seconds of the opening round. Dominance here from Joshua Pasio. Mount position. Dominguez almost gives his back.
One too many times. Dominguez went to the well, trying that hip bridge to get out. Pasio finally figured it out on the fourth attempt. Was able to settle his hips and really just trap Dominguez in that position. Look at some of these kicks by Pasio. Looks like he's swinging a baseball bat at Dominguez. Here's that Kimura. Check this out. It's such a beautiful submission attempt. And Dominguez is like, nope, nope. But he gets the sweep to end up on top. Check it out. Here it is. Dominguez tries to bridge out and escape from these elbows just being rained down. As he tries to bridge, Pasio settles his hips down and traps Dominguez. Wonderful. As you can see, Pasio is slowly starting to learn what Dominguez is doing. Now, it is his chance, if he does go back to the ground, to use the information that he's got to finish this contest. If he can get it back down to the mat.
Here, ready to rock and roll. Second round, set for three. Impressive in the opener was 21-year-old Joshua Pasio. Young man who began training in martial arts as a 12-year-old. Won several national wushu tournaments in the Philippines before transitioning to competing professionally in the cage. He's actually overweight as a child. Ready. And credits martial arts for helping him to shed the excess pounds and turn him into the elite athlete he is today. Let's see if Dominguez can get his hands off here. And indeed, that's how he opened up the second stanza.
Barely gives him a buzz cut on that right kick again. But Dominguez counters nicely with that left hook to the body.
Counter right hook there from Dominguez. The southpaw once again controlling center cage. Pasio on the outside. Turning back kick. Uchidogeri from Joshua Pasio. Dominguez edges forward. Does have that one punch. Precision. So too, Pasio. Joshua Pasio back in the winner's circle.
That was superb. Out of nowhere, Joshua Pasio closes the show. Beautifully done. Turns the lights out. Look at this. Misses. Spinning back fist right on the button. Goes low with the leg kick. Follows it around. The guard is down.
It's just when we said Dominguez had one punch KO power, just as we said it. Joshua Pasio, one punch KO. Good night, Roy Dominguez. A spinning back fist of the highest order.
Pasio does it all. Not only can he grind on you and finish you with the ground and pound and submissions, but now we're seeing the knockout power of Joshua the Passion Pasio.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Mr. Kent Chen, has put a stop to this contest after 38 seconds in the second round for your winner by way of knockout, Joshua Pasio.
Listen to the ovation here in Manila. Tears of joy for Joshua Pasio. Back in the winner's circle.
Against Aoki, challenger against champion, lightweight belt at stake. One championship at the Singapore Indoor Stadium. great crowd, very noisy. This is what they came for. Right hands from Foalyang early on, wanting to land those big punches as soon as he can before Aoki can get to grips with him.
Immediately, Aoki comes open-handed, no strikes thrown, gets into the clinch, and it is no surprise that he wants this fight as quickly as he can to the ground.
Strong man Foalyang, tough to get him to the ground. He'll rely on technique, just as he did there. Now, how good is Foalyang's submission defense? And can he get back onto his feet where he'll be more dangerous?
Aoki is so strong from these positions. Once he gets those hands on you, it's just like he has clasped, like he's just magnetized to your body. He keeps such tight pressure in every inch that he slides his body that he easily passes into side control, laces the hands. He's got deceptively long limbs. He's got a great reach, and he easily slides around. Nice, but he jumps onto the back of Foalyang. They're dry, too. There's no sweat on the body, so it's a lot harder to slip out of these positions. Foalyang is very explosive. He likes to burst into positions, but Aoki's dry, so he's clinging onto the back like a koala bear.
They're directly above us here at cage side. Good strength from Aoki.
Armbar, possible armbar here. It looks like he's going for it. It looks like he's setting up a Kimura now. Taking the back, he uses it to hold on to the position. Now he's got the back and the body triangle.
Foalyang will have trained for these kind of positions intensively over the past few weeks.
Yeah, but you just don't know if he has the caliber of grappler out there in Baguio like Shinya Aoki.
I think it's inevitable that he doesn't have it. This is the real thing. This is the biggest test for him.
And even if he does have great grapplers in his camp, they're not going to be able to emulate the style that Aoki has. He's so unique. He's so versatile. And he's so different. He's so creative. Nobody in the world is like Shinya Aoki.
This fight being beamed to 118 countries around the world. Tremendous level of interest in this contest. The flagship of one championship in many ways, Shinya Aoki.
Let's go.
Mitch, you've fought and grappled with, trained with Shinya Aoki before. You haven't fought him as such, but you've trained with him so many hours. Just how tough is it?
Yeah, Steve, I've spent hours on the mat with this guy, and I don't last very long. I don't last as Edward's doing a great job, and he's able to slide out.
And he's back on his feet, and that's where
impressive.
He wants to be. Great impetus for Foalyang fans now. What can he do with this opportunity?
That's a victory all unto itself, but now he's going to have to be very careful. Ooh, he jumps into a nice little knee there. He should have circled around and created more space because Aoki immediately goes to the clinch. He's got those hips laced up, so Foalyang really can't go anywhere, and he uses a beautiful body lock trip takedown. And now Foliang's up against the cage.
He's okay.
1 minute 30 left of this opening round. Most of it has been on the deck with Aoki in charge. Elbow to the head of Foalyang.
Foalyang was able to get back into guard, a better position for him. Not as much danger, pushes off.
Great strength again from the Filipino.
Look how tight he immediately magnetizes himself to Foalyang, letting him go nowhere.
Thrives on the contact, the Japanese fighter, doesn't he? Doesn't want any space between you and him.
Foalyang's doing a good job. He's got to break this body lock. You don't want to let your opponent get double underhooks and get that tight body lock, because Shinya's probably going to end up going to a trip here and drag Foalyang back down to the mat. You can see him trying to pick him up, but Foalyang maintain a good base.
Five rounds this one, potentially. Don't forget, championship contest.
Judges will score the bout in its entirety, and
not round by round. We'll go to Rich Franklin when this one's done to get his thoughts on the first 5 minutes.
Good balance shown by Foalyang, because he went for that outside trip there, and Foalyang was able to maintain his balance and stay on his feet. And he actually looks like he's going to get out of the first round after some very dangerous. The entire hush has fallen over the Singapore Indoor Stadium as this packed crowd is just waiting for Shinya.
Oh, nice good trip.
Beautiful.
beautifully timed. Right as Foalyang was throwing that knee, Aoki swept that foot out and just scored with another takedown. We can see here's Aoki threatening with a possible Kimura, was able to maintain that position with the Kimura using those long legs to secure the back and just jump on there with that body triangle. It's probably pretty evident how this round has been scored, but let's go to Rich Franklin just to get his opinion on what's happening so far.
Yeah, obviously this fight is all about the ground control. Aoki is taking control with the takedowns. He's controlling Foalyang on the ground, but you know, Foalyang has showed some glimpses, and this is what I talked about before the fight. He's very unorthodox. He works himself out of weird positions, which is a very difficult thing to do against a guy like Aoki. After all, you've had him on top of you, and you know what it's like. So it's going to be interesting because Aoki has been pressure in the first round, and I wonder if that's going to actually affect his gas tank at all. And you know, Foalyang, he'll stay unorthodox the whole fight, and we're going to see if that actually poses some problems in the later rounds. At this point, if the fight was stopped, obviously Aoki.
Fight!
We're only 1/5 of the way through this contest as scheduled, though. And those Baguio trainers training at altitude are very, very fit. Cardio is a big deal for them.
Looks like a kick was the first strike that Aoki has thrown this entire fight.
Foalyang trying to confuse with movement laterally, side to side, changing direction constantly.
That's what he needs to do, Steve. But he's a...
Really let go with that kick, and there was the familiar spinning back fist. Didn't connect.
He can't help it. He's put himself into a dangerous position when he spins by giving the back to Aoki like that. But he says he can't help it. It's just something that naturally happens. He loves the spinning attacks. That's good. That's good. Looked like it was a possible headbutt to the chin there. Yuji Shimada is warning Foalyang about it.
Whenever Aoki shoots for the takedown, he's got to be careful of knees and all sorts of things coming at him because Foalyang will have trained for that. Land those blows when you can.
Good movement. Aoki's trying to pressure Foalyang up against the cage. Foalyang's got to start moving. He can't let him get that close.
He's an expert at just cutting you off, isn't he, Aoki?
He's cutting beautiful corners. Again. Nice defense there from Eduard as he throws off the double leg attempt from Aoki.
Great strength from the Filipino to do that. He's got tree trunk legs, as so many of the fighters in Baguio do. Training in those hills, tremendous strength in the lower limbs. That was just, everything was thrown into that. It didn't land, but it nearly knocked Aoki over just with the draft.
I'm liking the lateral movement of Foalyang. He's moving really well on his feet. He's just not putting any strikes behind it, so he's not scoring. He's not hurting Aoki, except with these big, scary strikes, which I think I can kind of feel the wind from over here. Oh, nice little knee, but again, he gives himself into the takedown.
It was a very ambitious effort, wasn't it, from Eduard? He was always going to expose himself if it didn't pay off.
High-risk move with huge payoff capabilities, but now he's on the mat with one of the world's greatest.
Approaching the midway point in the second round. One championship, lightweight title on the line. The champion in the white shorts, the challenger in the red.
Aoki's doing the right thing. He's pushing him up against the cage, dropping him with those elbows. He's not only scoring points, but he's also softening up Eduard. Foalyang's trying to create some kind of space. And that's exactly what he's able to do.
Oh,
but Aoki
he's done
just
well.
Immediately latches onto him.
Back on his feet for Foalyang, but
that's
still
it.
Not out of trouble.
It's better than where he was, so that's improvement.
Knees to the body from the Filipino. Ideally, he wants space between the two of them so that he can attack with legs and punches, but these knees to the body will be punishing.
Nice knees from Foalyang. He scored a bit there and was able to break away. These might be moral victories for Foalyang, but I don't know if the judges score on survival.
Five rounds, it's a marathon, not a sprint. Foalyang knows that if he can just keep surviving, the chances will come.
You can see Aoki's not expending any energy.
He's completely relaxed into every single one of these positions that he gets into, and Foalyang's not landing any strikes that are doing any significant damage to Aoki yet.
Contrastingly, in the stand-up, Foalyang expending a lot of energy, lots of lateral movement.
That was a nice little lower leg kick there thrown by Foalyang. Aoki acknowledged it well. He was like, yeah, you got me.
Aoki almost static at times. So focused, is he?
He's just waiting for the takedown. You know what Aoki's going to do. He's going to get to the clinch, try to get the takedown, but can you stop it? That's the question. That's the puzzle everybody's been trying to solve in one championship.
Oh, kick to the knee from Eduard. Hard feet, he's got hard shins.
He needs to keep doing that over and over again, attacking those legs, because that's going to limit the movement of Aoki.
The strength of that punch. Aoki backed off. Just hit him in the chest, I think. Oh, but there we go again. Again, it was low. There's the spinning back kick. Getting a bit of momentum now. The kick to the torso. The crowd getting behind Foalyang. There'll be plenty of Filipinos here in Singapore. Punch to the body. Is that an area of potential weakness for Shinya? And Eduard Foalyang ends the second round on the up and up.
That was a better round for Foalyang. He was able to use the strikes and start to open up. And he's really starting to dictate the space. There's that big head kick and spinning back fist that just barely missed. Big attempt, good, he stopped the takedown. These are moral victories. These are gonna add to his confidence. You can see Foalyang immediately gets into guard, keeps it nice and tight. Rich Franklin, what do you got so far?
Well, I'll tell you, Foalyang had a couple takedown defenses in that round. They ended up on the ground, which wasn't a takedown by Aoki. However, Aoki added to his ground control lead. At the beginning of the round, it was really interesting to me because even though Foalyang was moving side to side laterally, Aoki was moving in such a way that Foalyang couldn't really commit to anything. He couldn't mount any damage on the feet. Anytime he committed, he knew he was going to end up on the ground. But at the end of that round there, you could see that Foalyang was moving forward more and more, and Aoki was back. And at the end of that round, you could see that Foalyang was landing the strikes. He closed the lead a little bit there, but still, if the fight was stopped at this point in time, Aoki would still have the decision.
I like what you're saying there, Mitch. Little moral victories here and there, confidence boosters for Foalyang, just that he can bring forward. Give himself a little bit of encouragement. The attack from Aoki.
There's that flying knee again. That is getting timed very well. But look at this. He's able to shrug.
Oh, and the knee to the head as well. And Foalyang has got Shinya in trouble. Punches to the head. The noise behind me is deafening. Foalyang looking for the finish. Shinya Aoki is standing very, very closely, watching hard. Nothing's coming back from Aoki. We're only half a minute into this third round. It's perpetual motion from the Filipino. And it is all over. We have a new one championship lightweight title holder. And his name is Eduard Foalyang.
He did it! Eduard Foalyang shocks the world with an upset victory to become the new one lightweight world champion. Quite possibly the biggest upset we've ever had in one championship.
Well, I tell you, there were a few people who could have seen it coming. Rich Franklin, give us your thoughts.
I don't even know what to say at this point in time. It's unbelievable, you know? Foalyang had those high-risk moves, the spinning kicks, the spinning, and he actually attempted that jump knee once or twice earlier in the fight. And you knew that if it landed, it was going to pay off for him, and it paid off right there.
You can see from the replay, Aoki offering nothing in return, defending as best he could, but nothing was coming back, and that was the deciding factor in Yuji Shimada's decision to stop the fight. And the tears of emotion, so apparent. It's been a long time coming for Eduard Foalyang, but his moment has arrived, and the Philippines are enjoying it just as much as he is.
Ladies and gentlemen, your referee, Yuji Shimada, has put a stop to this fight after 41 seconds in the third round. For your winner, and new one lightweight world champion, Eduard Foalyang.